Welcome to the Times of the Signs. My name is Barry Signs. Wait, no, that's your name.
I'm Joe Signs.
So I'm Joe Signs. This is Barry Signs, and that's why we're calling it Times of the Signs, but also related to the signs of the times of these last days. So Barry actually has a lot of experiences in, well, we both have a lot of experiences, but Barry's has been specifically around, what would you say, being single for so long?
Yeah, I like to put a positive spin on it where
yeah,
I'm on a mission.
Ooh, I like that. So one thing I've...
Because it's true, honestly.
One way to introduce Barry for me is, we were born and raised here in Iowa. And we are brothers. But Barry had a specific mission, and it's very obvious that he's had this, but it's been, he's been single for, and in our culture, in our church, it's more uncommon. And the culture is pressuring people to get married. That could be taken as negative. So a positive would be Barry has been sent on a mission to do certain things as a single man. How about that?
Sure.
And you've been able to reach, see things from that perspective for a long time, and there's a danger that comes with that. A danger meaning a certain sickness, and that is bitterness. And that is negativity and a poison. And Barry has been on a mission to get rid of that. And so he's even gone on to write a book called The Single Zombie Apocalypse. So you can check that out on Amazon.
Yeah.
So The Single Zombie Apocalypse by Barry Signs, and he is relating the real zombies that we can become in life. So it's been interesting because as he's been going on this journey, I've seen a lot of different ways that we can all become zombies, and it's a pretty telling, and it's pretty much the same trial, meaning the same attitudes, the same bitterness, the same pride, or whatever you want to call all these different names, but it all really is the same thing. And that's I was just reading in the scriptures. Let me bring it up because this was this morning. And okay. This is for those of you who don't know what the Book of Mormon is, it is another testament of Jesus Christ, and we believe in that. And there is a prophet called Nephi. He was writing down some of Jesus' teachings as he visited people in the Americas. And Jesus taught this. Okay, so let me go back up just a little bit. Behold, this is Jesus. I give unto you a commandment that ye suffer none of these things to enter your heart. To enter into your heart. So it is better that ye should deny yourselves of these things, wherein ye will take up your cross, than ye shall be cast into hell. So it's ye either take up the cross or go to hell. Yeah. and that and And, you know, we can spend hours and days and whole episodes on just what that really actually means, hell, but that's state of mind, I think. And so what does that mean, taking up the cross? And so that's why I think I brought it back to, it's all the same trial. It's either the two.
Yeah.
The trial of being in hell, mm-hmm. or the trial of taking up the cross, which is also very difficult, but it's either one, you gotta choose.
Yeah.
So it's, this life isn't easy for anyone. So anyway, but Barry's has been focused on the single zombie apocalypse, because there are a lot of difficult trials with that culturally, in our culture, in our church culture, but we see it out in the world anyway. And this is what we're gonna spend some time talking about. It's maybe tons of episodes about this specifically, but at least, you know, talking about it and getting ideas out there and discussing. So welcome to our table. We invite you here.
Forgive me as I start talking and answering questions. I don't really have my gears going yet, because, you know, whenever the recorder button is pushed, I kind of shut down a little bit. So it'll get going. But it might help if you ask, like, a question.
Yeah, so I think actually, I mean, that's a great way to put it. In your book, I think the question is, what caused you to write this book? I mean, look at how many subjects are in here. It's so small that you, like, there's so many different subjects in it. Anyway, so that's what I want to know. Like, so just kind of start painting the picture for somebody that hasn't been through it with you, of what got you to this point, and why would you write a book?
Well, it's I can go back quite a bit a fundamental reason. I'll just explain first that there's so many topics on here because I designed this book as a guide, and so when you go throughout the topics, you just kind of scan through and figure out which one relates to you the most, which one stands out. So it's, you could read it cover to cover, but the best way to doing it is just finding out which one relates to you and then going straight to that. And it also is just to spark a conversation about things that you may have not have considered before. You may not have experienced some things before yet. So I wanted them all together in one book, and the topics kind of touch on it. And I explain some of my thoughts and some of thoughts on from other people, but it doesn't go into depth as a person who's an expert in relationships would do. This one is kind of just, it sparks the conversation and on the different topics. So this goes far back. I never really considered putting this into a book, but I'll share an experience when I was 25 that started my thoughts that I've been on a mission, and explain a little bit of that, because some people may think that's you know, you're deceived. Why would you be on a mission as a single person? Wouldn't you miss out on all these opportunities if you're thinking that way? And so the thing is, I check up with the Lord constantly.
Well, that's one of the trials.
Yes, and it's,
'cause family has even done this to you. I've probably done it to you.
Yeah.
Of like, why aren't you trying this?
I've done that to myself. Yeah, so. And you go through, and taking up the cross isn't just one time, but it's like a daily thing almost. And then you go through cycles of, you know, of doubt and regrets and whatever cycles that you go through. But then you have where to go back to for a source, and that comes back to your relationship with Jesus Christ and hearing his voice again. And a lot of times it's been reminders that he gives me that most of the time when I hear his voice, it's through a conversation like this. So either with a family member or a friend or something, we get into a spiritual discussion and then it comes up again. And then the perspective comes back when, you know, just an hour ago, I was like, I lost the perspective. And then that's what church and those and the scriptures do. It gives you that perspective again.
Yeah.
And then you feel comforted and then you feel his voice and you feel. So that's the fundamental things that that anybody would have to do with whatever trial they're facing. You know, because whatever it is, we could go through a bunch of different topics of what a trial may be.
Well, that's exactly what I've, so when we've talked about this before, this book, The Single Zombie Apocalypse, this, we were thinking of ideas of, married zombie apocalypse, children zombie apocalypse, single parenting zombie apocalypse. There's so many different career zombie apocalypse.
Yep.
Stuck in the system of, yeah, so in that career of you're just like, I'm dead inside, but I'm not. Anyway, so there's lots of zombie apocalypses. And so yours is just obviously stemming from this.
So I have other books that I want to write that are on those topics. Yeah. And we talked about, you were writing, thinking of writing one. Some too. Back when I was 25, I went through, it was the first time that I went through this cycle of doubting my entire life. And I've seen people as young as 19 or 20 go through this. So it's like everybody goes through this where they think they're never going to get married in their life. All the fears and all the regrets, maybe they just got rejected or something, and then all the fears come crushing down. It's like, oh my God. Or maybe they just broke up with their fiance, and I've seen that many times. So that's, or just a relationship. Maybe it's just a month long dating somebody and then you get your hopes up and then it's crashed. So whatever it does to trigger that, you go through that cycle of doubting everything. And so when I was 25, I was going through this whole thing. And it was the hardest thing to do, but since then it's gotten easier. I can't say it's easy every time, but it's a constant. It's the first time I swallowed the idea that the timing is not yet for me. And so this could be with anybody with any trial. Like I compared it to a lady who was, who had two kids and she wanted a third one. That was her trial, and she couldn't get pregnant, and it was this huge trial for her. Like she went through her own cycles of like, what's wrong? I'm doing everything right. I'm trying to. And she concluded with the lesson was for hers that she had to accept whatever the Lord's will above what she desired, even that. So it was a hard thing. And then you could tie that together with Abraham and his wife, Sarah. Like you can find these examples in the scriptures. And so this trial is very common. Even his son Isaac, when he finally had a kid, and it was Isaac went through that same trial, and his wife that he finally found. And then they went through a trial of being barren for 10 years. So there's that principle behind that. So when I was 25, I was thinking about this topic, and I was like, what's going on? And I remember on the road driving around delivering pizzas, and I started thinking in this way, and I was like, maybe the time hasn't come and I need to accept that. And it's a very hard thing. I call it a Gethsemane moment, where when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and he wanted the cup to pass from him. And so it's that principle that he had to go through, where it was so much for him to accept that, to swallow that, the bitter cup of what's the Lord's will. And as soon as that happens, I've learned that the Lord always sends his angel, that he always sends his spirit. He always sends a something encouraging. And that's what he did for Jesus in that moment. Is Jesus said, not my will, but thine be done. And then God the Father sent an angel strengthening him. So, and that's when we hear the Lord's voice. It may not be what we want to hear, but we're hearing it, and that's encouraging in and of itself. So I remember probably going home that night or something, and finally swallowing it, like swallowing that idea. I'm like, okay, if this is the case, then I'm going to accept that. And it was very hard to do, by the way. I was like, I'm going to have to accept that. And I need to just consider that idea. Because that idea has always been like, no, I don't want to consider it.
Yeah. That you would be single for the rest of your life.
Right.
Like accepting the reality that could be true for you.
Right. Yep.
Which is, or whatever that is for each of us, accepting it's, that you won't be able to have children for the rest of your life.
Yes.
Or accepting, yes. So accepting that my career might not be what I want it to be.
For right. Me. It's the Abrahamic test of what it could be called. And some people may have gotten paralyzed and now they can't walk for the rest of their life, but they go through a faith, their roots go deeper in that moment. And that's where you really hear his voice. So in that moment when I actually swallowed it and like sincerely did that, and then that's when the floodgates opened. And that's when I saw the perspective that he had. And that's what I call, that's what you would call his voice, is that when you get an understanding, an illumination of perspective, and oh, I see what he's doing. And I saw multiple people in my life, at work, with my roommates, with anybody I associated myself with, that they are virtually holding on to my hand. When I got that impression, I'm like, oh, there is purpose. There is a reason. That was just the first initial the time that I've realized that. And so I can't say that it's easy every time, but it's like every time I go into a cycle, something triggers that cycle of doubt and am I sure about that answer? Am I really? Am I crazy? Am I this? Am I that? And that's when I go back into asking the Lord again, and I have to put myself in that sincere spot and accepting his will to hear his voice again. So it's a process, but at least I know what to do. And I've gotten a lot better at doing that and faster at it.
Yeah.
Whereas before, maybe I'd go through a week or two, or I don't know, a month or something, of just in that cycle and not knowing and like
doubting and kind of depression-esque
things. Yeah. It's very difficult to snap out of it until you're in the right place, maybe at church or somebody. That I go to the temple, when I go in the LDS church, those times I ponder and I really ask again, like I get to that sincere spot and I really ask again. And that's when I get sometimes the very same day within minutes, or sometimes it might be the next day or something, but I get, when I'm paying attention, I get an answer. And it's always a perspective conversation usually, and with a trusted friend or family. So that's usually how it comes.
Yeah, I've seen that. Because that's literally what happened to me this last week or two. A couple different ups and downs, but I've noticed that same thing where, especially in 2000, well, from 2015 up until the COVID was some of the hardest trials that I had been through. And just mentally. They would be months, sometimes 6 months of that cycle that you're talking about. And I just noticed that same thing, that as I've been going through them, they've gotten shorter. And so I've that I think you're right, or I know you're right, is that it's that you're able to learn from the last one and just understand that you will go through more of them, but you will have that added benefit or extra gift of, well, you've been through it before. What did you do to endure it? Because you can't control when it goes away. Mm-hmm. That's what I've noticed. But it has gone away faster, based on just because of the amount of times of going through it. And then I can say, oh, you know what? I know that I'm going to get through this, mm-hmm. because it's happened so many times before. Because that's the misconception I think there is that it just never happens again, or we try to go get, we pray for that blessing so that it never happens again. And that's never the pattern that I believe that our Father in Heaven has. It's like, no, you're going to go through it again, and you're going to keep learning as you go through each time. And then, but it is the same thing. It's these conversations that will come up. And I think that is then directly the purpose of ministering.
Yeah, exactly.
That's so the definition of ministering then is doing what Christ would do with other people, that's how we get through these things, is through the strength of other people and how they their spirits can bless us. And so anyway, point is, I totally agree, and I've seen those same things in my life.
Well, one of the recent experiences that I've had with a couple of people have mentioned my character and how I carry myself, and they said similar things. They said, oh, Barry is just a calm, collected person who's sure, and he's, you know, and it makes me laugh inside, because I know what they're saying. It's not just part of my personality that I just kind of go along and I just take it, or I somehow don't feel it, you know, it somehow just skips over. But it is very opposite to that, to where there's a price to pay to get here, to get to the equilibrium or whatever in your spirit. And when I say that, I mean, like, get the spirit back to where you hear the Lord's voice again, and you're like, okay, I'm sure again. But it's sometimes I'm pacing back and forth in my house, and I'm just like, what's going on? And, like, you know, for more than one day, for a week or two, that was the latest one, for probably a couple of weeks, and just like, what's going on? Is it, what's my status now? Am I still good? Am I still sure? Is this still the right way? Is it like, and so, that, and I know that I have to be in the right places. When I surround myself with good people and, at church, and then, family and friends, that's when the answers come. Like, that's when the perspective comes. And then when I get that again, I make sure I, tell the Lord, thank you. I see your hand in my life. I accept it. Thank you for that strengthening thing. And so then I'm sure again. I'm back right back to where I'm sure. My mind is clear, and I know that I'm continuing forward. That is very fragile. So delicate is a good word for it too. And so when that spirit is with me and I have perspective, I'm at peace, and I really heard the Lord's voice again, and that reassurance, and then that could be triggered by something, and then it cascades right back into the same old thing. And so when I'm in that cycle, and I've seen other people's in the cycle, they doubt everything. Their everything in their entire life is like, all my decisions are, I'm doubting all of them, you know,
and doubting God and
doubting God. Yeah. Yeah, it's, yeah. Like, and so then I'm better at it now, to where I'm like, oh, I'm doing that again. I know what that is. So now I'm sure that when I pray and ask and I'll wait for the Lord, that his reassurance comes. And I'm like, okay, I know what voice that is now. So I know what the Lord's voice feels like. I know what those recycling thoughts are like. Mm-hmm. And I just had a conversation with my friend about that, about some insights about what that is. Just one insight is you have devils following all of you, all of your life, giving you these thoughts, and they can't wait to find that weak moment or that trigger moment to like bring all of those same thoughts you've had your entire life, mm-hmm. and just recycle them into your head again. And then you think you haven't progressed in your life at all. And so you're feeling, it's like you're feeling their damnation upon your own soul. But we talked about it and be like, no, it's actually their damnation. I'm moving on. They're trying to convince me that my own condition is what their condition is. So that makes sense. But mm-hmm. yeah,
no, that's super cool.
So that's actually what turned into the book, is all of these experiences with a lot of conversations that's happened over the years.
Yeah.
So this is just around the kitchen table hundreds of times with various people and trying to gain insights of what's going on, questioning what's happening. And these are the perspectives, the struggles and then the perspectives that come when we've come out of these. And there's like little gems of nuggets of gold, I feel like, that we've collected. And so I put them into the book.
I think what we want to do with this whole, what do you want to call this, a show, but we're just recording what we normally talk about anyway. But we want to invite more people into that conversation, because we've had it with, say, another friend, and they would come in and have this conversation, and then they were like, that was amazing. I want to be part of more of this. So basically that's why we're recording them now, is just kind of, come along with us on this adventure. I mean, we'll talk about, dreams, visions, miracles, things that we've seen in other people's lives, things that we've seen in our lives, and what we've gained from that and what we're gaining still today. I mean, literally learning on a daily basis on how to navigate life, and also anticipating the second coming, which is not a terrifying thing, but it's a joyful, exciting thing. And we don't want to really talk about anything that's fearful, but rather hopeful. And so that no matter where we're at in life, we and no matter who's listening, that today we all can be part of God's kingdom. And it's okay, he meets you wherever you're at in life. That's what I love about him so much, is that we've had friends that have been to the darkest places that you could be, mentally and physically, in prison or mentally darkest places, and yet have come out of it. And we all have that chance to be able to be filled with light, and that's all we want to do, is share that light. So I think we'll end it there for our first conversation. Thanks for joining us.